A very warm welcome to all of you. The post-lunch sessions are always the most difficult, I believe. Nisha is on her way and she will join us midway in the conversation. Okay. So today we are going to talk about the jugalbandi between influencers and brands and how they work together to contribute to each other's growth stories. Influencer marketing, as we all know, has come a long way. It has moved beyond the realm of, you know, merely being an improvement in modern marketing towards being a very crucial and significant part of the overall marketing plans. In fact, I was going through one of the reports that said that 75% of marketers consider influencer marketing as a big part of their marketing plans. So with that, I would want to shoot the first question to Nikki and Kunal. So the space of celebrityhood, as we all know, in the entertainment world or the ad world, was primarily dominated by actors and musicians. Now we see the needle shifting towards influencers. Can you throw some light on this, and how do you see this evolution, you know, panning out, and how has it really evolved in the past few years?
So I think taking off from what you just mentioned, I think some of us who are traditional marketers over years, you know, going back to those days where we are so used to making television commercials, and the moment you used to think of a television commercial, you needed to, you know, you started by thinking of the A-listers and the Bollywood and cricket, which goes across India, right? From there to today, I mean, we've traveled a journey, I think, and frankly, with it's actually the viewers or the people consuming content who have made marketers move the needle, right? So there's been a paradigm shift in how we look at marketing and how we look at influencers, right? In fact, I mean, we were having a quick conversation before the panel started, and in fact, COVID did a great service to the whole community by getting a large-scale influencer content adoption, right? So today, I mean, earlier when I used to look at pan-India celebrities to carry a message, today there is the capability that has been given to marketers to be able to target different audiences with different kind of messages by the same brand, right? And I think that's the immense potential that influencers bring, and that's really opened up marketers' eyes to what influencers can do for the brand.
Sure. Nikki, can you give us a perspective from the influencer side?
I think there were multiple factors at play which definitely, you know, have caused this gradual shift. I think firstly, definitely just the, you know, onset of Instagram and other social media platforms, and like he said, after COVID, the fact that everyone spent so much more time on these platforms that, you know, brands and agencies and the marketing teams realized that there was a considerable shift from your conventional TV ads to now the digital space. Then I just think that, you know, the reason where we guys came into play was that even on social media, you know, brands understand now that the conversions that, say, an influencer can bring versus a celebrity will be different. And in this case, the former bringing them higher conversions. And that is because the key factor at play here is that, you know, a celebrity is a very aspirational figure to the audience. And they understand that when they're talking about a brand, then it is, you know, an ad. Whereas we are not celebrities, but more like pseudo celebrities, in the sense that we're like them, but we have the aspirational value. And I feel that kind of makes us very relatable and puts us in a very unique position where if we tell them to buy something, it has more of an impact than their favorite celebrity that they've seen on screen all their lives. So I just think because of these factors, you know, I think everyone slowly realized that there was a much needed shift in the approach in which digital marketing was being done. And I think that's happening now.
Nisha, hi, welcome. That's okay. We'll blame the Delhi traffic, that's fine. Okay, Vikram, so my next question is for you. As we were speaking backstage, so for the industry that you know deal with, for you, your employees are your biggest influencers or the biggest ambassadors, so to say. Can you throw light on this, and how often does an influencer marketing campaign work for you?
Thank you. Hi guys, my name is Vikramjeet Dhyana and I head marketing for Bajaj Allianz General. In our company, we're very, very clear that our employees are the ambassadors, and nothing against influencers or people who represent their own body of work. But because insurance is a very unique product, it's when you buy insurance, you're not getting a tangible piece or a watch or a cell phone, right? When you buy insurance, we say, we will be there when something wrong happens to you. So it's a promise that you're selling. And that's why for us, we've realized that our employees are the flag bearers of the brand. Because when they are selling insurance, the end consumer knows that if God forbid something happens, this office mein HR employees hain who will be there for me and if I need something, right? Versus if we take a face, approaching that face will be impossible for Aam Janta, right? They won't be writing to them ki hume claim dilai hai. So in our company, we're very, very clear that employees, so if you happen to visit our page, all reels are all in-house and you'll see employees in them. All films that you see are employees. All music used in the film is done by employees, because we've realized that when they make content for your brand, especially a brand like Bajaj Allianz General and a commodity like insurance, the product is a lot more honest because they are actually creating products and selling those. So we've seen solid engagement on those activities where we've made reels or films. We've got a lot of appreciation because we tag them, so the world knows that these are the employees and not people who've been asked to do an activity for the brand, right? So I think that's worked really, really well for us. Having said that, we had this CSR campaign where we tied up with Rani Rampal, who's the hockey captain. We sponsored hockey kits and the entire ecosystem for 500 young girls in Delhi. So it's not that we don't use influencers, but on a day-to-day basis, if we have to, even for bigger campaigns, it's our employees. We've got employees who've got followers upwards of 50,000. My MD has some 7 lakh followers on LinkedIn, which is kind of impossible. A big chunk of them have 50,000, 60,000, 70,000, because we are encouraging them to really get active. And when they write something, the kind of influence that we get in terms of understanding the product, because it's also a complex product. General insurance is not very, very simple, right? There's a lot of ifs and buts, do's and don'ts, inclusions, exclusions. So when you really know the subject is when you can truly, truly embrace it and sell it. So that's how we look at influencer in terms of selling insurance.
Sure, fair enough. Okay, so Nisha and Kunal, my next question is actually for you. How do you really evaluate and invest in an influencer collaboration? What are some of the top checkpoints that you have whenever you are, you know, leveraging this part of the marketing effort?
Sure. I think to answer that question, I mean, every brand has certain objectives when they are getting into influencer or looking at influencer as a medium. There are certain brands which look at the bottom of the funnel, which is essentially more driving consideration and conversions, right? There are certain brands, for example, I come from the FMCG space, so obviously a higher penetrated kind of a category, influencers have a very different role to play. There, the role is more in terms of driving certain elements for the brand, right? Certain imagery elements amongst consumers, and hence the selection of influencers then becomes important, either from a category perspective or the values that you want to drive as a brand, right? So let me talk about the brand that I work on, which is India Gate Basmati, right? And if you look at it, there are certain elements that we have identified that we talk about, right? We talk about inspiration as one element that we would want to own up, and we talk about nostalgia as the second element that we want to talk about, and the third element is humanity, which is about food wastage in India. Now, when I look at these values, and when we go about selecting the right mix of influencers who can deliver this kind of message, the selection becomes extremely important of the influencers. Once we devise that and once we do that, then it's also important to continuously monitor brand metrics in terms of whether certain imagery parameters of the brand are moving on those particular things, right? And that's what we consistently do. Because see, for a brand, until and unless we are consistent in what we are doing, it becomes difficult for us to see results on the brand. See, for a campaign which is intended to drive the lower part of the funnel, which is essentially sales or revenue, it's easier to measure. Because it gives you immediate, and with today, we marketers have become extremely greedy in terms of trying to look at data on how much conversion is happening basis this particular campaign that I'm running. But when you look at an objective like a brand metric, then you have to be more patient as a marketer. You need to consistently work towards it and work with the right curated influencer set of people to be able to drive those metrics. So that's it.
Okay. Isha, how about you?
Hi, Soumya. Hi, everyone. And hi, everyone. I'm really sorry. I just got stuck in Delhi traffic with Delhi rain. So figure. If I be honest to answer the question you've just asked, it's a very cluttered space to make a decision in. How to select the right influencer for your brand, right? Especially in an environment where narrative is more important than facts. So when that is a reality, then who's the loudest? Who's the most convincing? So as a brand, how do you not get swayed in that noise and then make a decision? I think that's a constant struggle as a brand, at least at Libas, we continuously, you know, ask ourselves. Secondly, of course, there are all the metrics which Kunal just pointed out, you know, all your engagement and et cetera, while that is super, super important eventually to justify the ROI. But for us at Libas, we have a very simple process we follow. We don't work with influencers. We promote our product. We promote our collections. So when we do that mass backward, it's very actually becomes the process becomes quite easy for us to then identify the correct set of influencers. So it's when we whatever we plan internally, we are planning around a campaign. We are planning around, okay, what is it spring, summer? Are we doing a celeb launch? Are we doing a collection launch or a new product launch? Or if there is a change of season, are we talking about a flagship sale? So when that is at the center of the conversation, then the choice of influencer becomes very easy because then we have to make sure that the right flavor is served. We also don't, nothing against big influencers like Nikki. We also most of the times can't afford them every day. But we try to ensure that we work with influencers or even OTT celebrities, which are trending. And we rather like to spend money in that cohort more because it serves a certain flavor to India. And then we combine our collection, et cetera, around it. That's majorly how we plan it.
Okay, I'm taking the liberty of asking you, how much do you spare for the influencer marketing campaigns out of your monthly marketing budget?
You didn't tell me when I asked me this. If I have to be technically correct, then I think of my social media marketing spends, 60% of my spends go on influencers. Again, like I said, like we don't work with influencers in a way where we want to work with influencers. That's the agenda. We are promoting our collection and products and we are a fast fashion brand. So for us, rotation is the key. So when we have to do that, we have to ensure that how are we serving it? And by default, consumer wants to consume content through influencers. We also have started doing this really interesting thing, which has worked really amazing for us. The CTR is close to 5x more than the BAU CTR, which is, so say we have launched a new collection. So instead of doing a catalog shoot only, of course, we need to do that because marketplaces have their, you know, restrictions, etc. So there is your regular catalog shoot. But then we also work with influencers to replace the first image on the website and on marketplaces because it seems more real. People can relate more. Okay, how will it look on me? And then our influencers are not like picture perfect influencers. They are regular people, but of course they have a certain following. We work with micro influencers a lot because engagement rate there is 6x more than your top tier influencers. We do work with top tier influencers as well for special campaigns. So that has worked really well for us. So again, send product is the hero and then we work with influencers to promote it.
So Nikki, my next question is for you. As we understand that marketing needs change depending on the market needs, right? How do you, who's one of the leading influencers in the industry, how do you keep yourself abreast with the changes in the ecosystem? And how do you as an influencer really zero down on one brand collaboration? What are your checkpoints?
To kind of adapt to the system for us, we really just focus on content because our love language is content. That's how brands understand what we talk about. That's how they, you know, get to know, like he also mentioned, what RPAT stands for. So, right now the attention span is so small that honestly, this is an everyday challenge, you know, so it does not come in phases. It's an everyday thing for a creator to kind of constantly evolve when it comes to what's happening in the market. In terms of the brands, obviously we all have our categories, you know, and that depends on what our audiences have been interested in all this while, depending on the content that they've consumed from us. And obviously there's data which kind of tells us, okay, this is what they're more interested in, etc. So we as creators usually try to work with brands that align with what our audience is interested in, because then that's just a win-win. So in that sense, it's pretty straightforward that a brand needs to, like today, if I talk about fashion and beauty on my page, then I know that if a fashion or beauty brand is coming to me, I can offer them what they want, plus give a lot of inputs based on what my upcoming events or plans are, where I can help them integrate their brand in a much, much more better way. So I just feel when I can bring that expertise on board, it's obviously better, right? So we also choose to kind of work with brands in that big category that we belong to. That's basically the main criteria,
Understood. So Vikram and Nisha, help me understand, what are some of the crucial metrics that you gauge whenever you are, you know, leveraging an influencer marketing campaign?
I mean, like I mentioned, like your usual engagement metrics, which is your, I think most importantly, which has changed the game for us, is selecting an influencer, the shares and saves algorithm. I think that how Instagram actually works the best.
Do you leverage
now.
AI and data as?
We do. Use AI very strongly to assess if, you know, of course, the follower base is correct. If the influencer has worked in the category we operate in, it's also very important for us, right? Like, I can't be working with an influencer, because there are so many now, in even on the micro level. Somebody who creates content for, say, like a Shein or an Urbanic, or somebody, say, you know, for like a Freakins, which are all very cool brands, but it doesn't serve the purpose for my brand. So our scouting process and evaluation process is very strict. Of course, then we are more lenient when we work with influencers. We give them absolute liberty, because I think I learned it the hard way after failing a couple of campaigns, that nobody knows their audience base better than the influencers. You're paying them a certain, you know, money, a certain amount of money. Trust them to do what they know best. But we are very strict with the scouting and evaluation process. So we ensure, firstly, that, you know, the category is served with the content they do. And also, is the influencer really honest with their audience base? I think authenticity and empathy and kindness and relatability are key themes, even if you read any of the major research reports and findings by all the major platforms, right? So we ensure that the influencer is speaking to its audience, be it about the pay they generate through the content they do, be it about their own insecurities or their own struggles. So when we find that right balance, I think we make our choice there.
Sure. Vikram and Kunal, would you want to throw light on the data and AI part of it?
Just a little bit about the first part first, where even though we don't use a lot of influencers, like I said, but whenever I come to these conferences, I like it because I see a lot of people who can be potential customers, because whoever I meet is predominantly underinsured, no matter how much they feel they have insurance, but whoever I meet is predominantly underinsured. And I say that with a lot of confidence because I know that, right? So our marketing predominantly focuses on educating people, because even today, a lot of us feel that we've got our particular amount of insurance covers, but it's still less, because a lot of people don't understand the value and the power that an insurance can give you, especially a general insurance, and the range of insurance. So from a pet dog to a pet cat to cyber to home, of course health and motor most of you would know, but the others a lot of people tend to ignore. I somehow feel cyber is the most important, so we spend a lot of time educating people about insurances. So our predominant focus is reach and engagement, so that we know that an X number of people at least saw, read and understood, hopefully, what it is, let alone buy. Buying is a secondary part, because if they don't know what it is, they will never buy. Because like I said, when you're buying an insurance, you're not getting anything in return. पहले हम फिर भी एक पॉलिसी देते थे बीएसजी करके, लॉट ऑफ पीपल आर जस्ट मिलिंग, सो यू गेटिंग एब्सोल्युटली नथिंग व्हेन यू बाइंग अ पॉलिसी. इट्स जस्ट अ प्रॉमिस कि व्हेन समथिंग हैपेंस वी विल बी देयर. बट सो द होल कॉन्सेप्ट फॉर अस इज टू इन्फ्लुएंस देम टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इट इज, बिकॉज वंस दे डू दैट, बजाज एलियंस जनरल इज वन ऑफ द लार्जेस्ट इंश्योरेंस कंपनीज, अ लॉट ऑफ देम विल कम बैक टू अस, बट पहले समझ जाए एंड देन कमिंग इज मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट. सो दैट्स हाउ वी काइंड ऑफ यूज द होल गैमिट.
I think some one point that I want to add here, I mean, we've spoken a lot about numbers and the science of the whole piece of how you measure the impact, right? I think as a marketer, I would also look at the art of doing it, right? And the art of doing it right, because I think all of us here understand that content is what is actually, you know, driving this whole wave of influencers, right? I'll give you an example. I mean, we did an outdoor campaign and laddered it up with an influencer campaign in Delhi. And, you know, one of the things that we just spoke about in terms of briefing, right? As marketeers, traditional marketeers, again, we are very passionate about the brief that we give. How does our brand look? Is it looking fine when the influencer is posting it out? You know, at the end of the day, you need to give liberty to the influencer because, you know, they are able to create magic out of it. Right. I think that is one of the critical things that as marketeers we need to understand and do that. And I personally have experienced multiple number of times that magic happens if you let the influencers do what they want to do, because they know their audiences the best. They know what's going to drive engagement and shareability within their set of audiences. I mean, one of the influencers, because we gave a very open brief, created a song out of it, which became, you know, a huge shareable piece. Right. So I think it is also important when we look at this whole influencer piece to be, as marketers, to be able to give that, you know, open brief through which there is the liberty that the influencer has. You know, you look at an influencer and you look through the feeds and look at the kind of organic content they do, and then you look at a branded piece and you can see it and understand that the brand has given a very tight, you know, closed brief. So you'll see the difference, and that then leads to results in terms of whatever you measure.
I think this is exactly what Nisha was trying to tell us. Okay, so coming down to my next question. So basically, we are witnessing a trend where certain platforms, say Facebook, for example, is witnessing a decline versus LinkedIn, which is witnessing a sudden uptake in, you know, influencer marketing campaigns. What is your opinion on this, and how, as brands and as the influencers, someone who belongs to the influencer community, how do you really navigate this new change? And how are you really preparing for it? Who wants to go first? Anybody?
I'll happily go for it, guys. Yeah, exactly. I was waiting for this question. Like I said, we are extensively using employees. LinkedIn, I think, has become so authentic these days, because seldom someone would post something which has little element on LinkedIn, because ya to kisi ko naukri chahiye hogi eventually kahin na kahin. So as a platform right now, I think it's the most honest. To a very large extent, of course, nothing can be 100%. There are loopholes in every platform that you go to. Some have bigger loopholes. I think LinkedIn has slightly smaller, slightly tighter loopholes. So I think the kind of influencers that are coming on LinkedIn, they know that targeting the corporates is also important, because that's where a lot of activities, campaigns, marketers are sitting who can identify what they are doing. So I personally feel LinkedIn as a platform is here to stay. I won't say Facebook is dying. Facebook is still serving an audience that is still on Facebook, and that's a big chunk of the Indians. So Facebook would never die, at least not right now. But LinkedIn definitely is catching up in a big way. A lot of people felt, especially when we started LinkedIn marketing and all of that, they said it's going to be useless. Koi nahi aayega. No one's going to really refer LinkedIn to accept products or listen to influencers or understand what they're saying. But I think the platform's built a strong sense of authenticity right now, because naukriya dila raha tha, they knew that authenticity hai. This was the only thing that was left, and people have started using it, and I think it's doing wonders.
I think I can just add a couple of points. I mean, we did a social campaign largely on the digital space called Ek Mutthi Chawal 2 years back. That was around food wastage. And we did a similar kind of a thing, initiative in our office, where employees came in and contributed, you know, a fistful of rice, and that got contributed. That's one of the best performing posts that we had on LinkedIn. And so you imagine what even the power of LinkedIn is, and the power of content, I believe, that, you know, where you can drive engagement.
Vicky, You may go first.
Yeah, I just think that, I mean, I don't know much about LinkedIn because I think from where I come from, it does not play a very important role. But just the Facebook versus Instagram debate, I just feel before Facebook could reach to a place, you know, where Instagram is right now, for example, before Facebook could become a platform that people were heavily monetizing from, obviously Instagram happened. And now I think Instagram is a platform around which, like we were discussing, you know, before the panel also, you now have, it's a structured industry. You have a lot of agencies, a lot of key stakeholders. And I think more than just a platform where you're sharing content, like for example, Facebook was, this is now a very money-making platform and a business in itself, you know, both for Instagram as well, because we have these meetings with Meta also quite often. So for them also, they understand that this is now a full-on business platform. So I think it's going to, it's not going anywhere because there's it has an industry around it now. So
sure, Nisha, what are your thoughts?
So funnily enough, I had a meeting with investors yesterday, and this was exactly the same question they asked me. So I'm very happy you're asking me this question because I didn't have to prepare for this one. So just to add first to what Vikram just said about LinkedIn, I think LinkedIn is doing everything other than Naukri Dilana. I think LinkedIn has just become, I don't really agree with you that it's the best authentic platform there is, but sure, better than the rest for sure. I'm very happy that platforms die. Because I think it really challenges you as a marketer. Because before platforms, bhi to brands bechte the, to tab kaise bechte the, right? It really challenges us. It puts us in a very uncomfortable place, of course. I mean, I don't want to say it to sound intelligent, but of course it puts us in a very difficult situation. But I think that's what challenges us to also become better marketers. And I think what it puts every brand in a bracket of is to work on your own media and work on your own website. Work on your own website experience. Work on creating better offerings and the engagement better. So that means connecting with your community, both online and offline. Create experiences on your website itself, right? With catalog videos where you can directly purchase off the website. Invest in tech. Create ticketed experiences, maybe, you know, work with influencers through affiliate networks on your website, which is, of course, social commerce is a big conversation as well. Create and build your emailer list. So I think that's WhatsApp communication is so huge, right? So we have a flagship call Purple Day Sale, and it's just coming towards the end of July. And we are working so much on creating and gamifying experiences with customers through WhatsApp. So, of course, there's WhatsApp marketing, which is a more expensive conversation. But on regular WhatsApp communication with our customers as well, what we have started doing is we have started creating office videos. So I agree with Vikram on that we also use our employees as influencers, because also they don't have the burden of having a certain number of followers, looking a certain way, having the perfect outfit, right, having a perfect background. So just by the virtue of volume, you create a lot of noise there. So I think that's an interesting way to work around changing platforms, because TikTok also died, right? It gave platform to so many people, so many influencers, especially from tier 2, tier 3. The amount of money they were making just within 3 months of the platform booming in India was immense. But it died away. So what really stays is content, understanding of content, understanding the consumer, understanding India. And not only India 1 and India 2, but India 3 and India 4. So I think that's what we all need to do as well. I think majorly that's what we believe in. I think Facebook hasn't really died again. I think it's a community-based platform now. You need to work with niche audience, niche influencers. Talk about issues which really matter to people as well. Again, if one platform dies, there are other two platforms which are, you know, I was just reading on the way here that Koo has finished their operations in India. And Koo was such a strong platform, right, when the entire Twitter thing was happening during COVID, just in 4 years. So there are other platforms. So start small, experiment, be an early experimenter on the other platform. Start with pilot campaigns, so before spending too much, and see what works for you. So yeah.
Okay, sure, fair enough. Taking cue from your answer, let's speak around social commerce a bit. As marketers, do you really feel that influencers are able to drive sales for your brand? Okay, sure. Whoever wants to go for it. And are there any challenges that you see?
The reason I am so enthusiastic to take that one is because I worked in my last job, I worked with Publicis Group. And I was hired, I was specially hired because they wanted me to set up the vertical of influencer affiliate marketing, popularly known as social commerce. So, and it was for Amazon. And this is the biggest affiliate network which India has ever seen. It was for 25 to 3,000 influencers in just 1 year. The challenge Amazon had was that they wanted to build better traction in the personal care and fashion as a segment. And the added challenge on that was that they wanted to tap into millennials and Gen Z. So Amazon pe basically koi nahi khareed raha tha fashion and beauty. People were going to Myntra or Nykaa, right? So that was their challenge. What it made us do was really scout influencers from everywhere in India. And that involved, because Amazon is a huge tech platform and they have dashboards, etc., etc., very complicated. So we had to empower influencers from the beginning. I had to hire 10, 15 people to run this program, of course. But even with 10, 15 people, we are in India. We have to understand everything on the phone. We have to understand everything on the phone. So like, to create that kind of campaign, it really made us understand that there is power in this. Because within 1 year, we were able to generate a revenue with the 2,500 influencers at a revenue of 250 CR. So it has merit, and I can say that because I've run it. I've run it with Indian influencers, young influencers, macro influencers in a category which is fashion and beauty, where the ticket size isn't even that big. So yeah, that's what I have to say.
Vikram, do you want to add anything to this?
Well, we've not done any such campaign, but we've done campaigns through employees and we've seen reasonable amount of return, like I said. And that's the sole reason why we stick around and do campaigns with employees, because the honesty and the trust with which they sell on social, especially, we've seen. So we've done a lot of health campaigns, cyber campaigns, like targeted LOB campaigns, because it becomes easier for them also to communicate. So we've done social campaigns and offline campaigns also, and it's given us solid amp in the number of policies that we've sold and the kind of revenue that we've got. And that's actual solid profitable business. So a lot of, because when they are going out there and being the face, they're getting in, they're getting consumers and customers who they know and who they trust. So the kind of business that they bring in is solid. And for insurance, the more profitable the business, the better. So I think that's worked very well for us.
Sure enough. Do you have anything to add, or should I move to the next question?
I think just one dimension. I mean, largely, if you look at category, the FMCG category, then I think most brands don't look at influencers from a conversion point of view or from purely from getting people to buy. But I think in certain categories like health, for example, I think there is a significant amount of influence that the influencer can exercise in terms of getting the consumer to come into the, that particular product category, because the kind of credibility they add, let's look at whey protein for that matter, the kind of value that an influencer, by virtue of talking about it, because of the expertise, that's the kind of value that I see.
Sure. Okay. So Nikki and Kunal, my next question is for you. We've gathered, some sense of how brands and influencers synergize together. Can you help me understand how influencer marketing agencies are contributing to this entire dynamic? Do you feel they're able to strategize, organize, and execute the campaigns better for you?
Yeah, I think agencies play a huge role, actually, in our industry now, because they essentially bridge the gap between the brands and the influencers. Because I think, especially like we were discussing, after COVID, the number of influencers that we have, it's not possible for the brand or the few people working in the brand to possibly know everyone who's out there or the new ones who are out in the market. So in that sense, yes, definitely, not only in terms of just helping them identify the right influencers, but also just literally from pin to plane, from helping them execute a campaign, to brainstorm a campaign, then to kind of tell them what the result of that campaign was. Agencies play a very important role for the brand, and even for us, definitely, to kind of, we even though no matter how long you've been in the industry, obviously you do not know every brand who's, you know, running a campaign or wants to run a campaign. So that's where the agencies come to play for us as well. So I definitely think they have a huge role to play. That's the plus. The negative, on the other hand, is that because for the agencies also, this market has become so competitive that their focus has slightly shifted to just kind of getting the brands on retainers, you know, or trying to kind of get them as permanent clients. And because of that, sometimes the suggestions that they give to the brands and then to the creators does not result in a good outcome for either. So, for example, sometimes we will receive a very, very strict brief, which from the get-go we'll know will not work for the brand. And if we tell the agency that, the agency will not take it to the brand because they do not want to be the bad guy here, you know, and then they want to kind of please their brand. And then,
so, how do you navigate such a situation?
I mean, honestly, you push back as much as you can as a creator while trying to find a middle ground between how to make the agency brief and the brand happy while still being true to your audience. So I think that's, again, a regular struggle. But I think, obviously, just like every other thing, this is a loophole there when agencies come into play. I feel sometimes if there's a direct communication between the brand and the creator, I'm pretty sure when you kind of explain the brand person directly that, you know, I think this is going to work, because I think for the creator and the brand, the goals align. You know, we both want the same things. But sometimes
the agency wants.
I think it's a very valid point, and I, from a marketer standpoint, kind of resonate with it, because I've seen cases of, or instances in my own experience of, you know, content getting, you know, not in the desired space because of the fact that the brief did not land right, right? And similar cases of where brands have maybe, you know, directly worked with influencers and landed the message much more impactfully, and you know, so I think there is a mutual empathy there between you know, the brand and the influencer. But having said that, it'll be wrong for me to completely say that there is no role of an agency. I feel the agency can definitely add value, both in terms of content, in terms of strategy of selection of influencers, right? For larger brands who have a more always-on influencer strategy, I think a well-thought-out strategy definitely brings more, you know, strategic lens to what the brand is trying to do, and that's the kind of value that an agency can definitely bring on the table. So, I mean, it's a yes and a no, but it's got to be taken by each decision to be taken. Yeah, it could go both ways.
Understood. So Nisha, help me understand, how do you maintain long-term relationships with an influencer, or do you believe that one-off campaigns can, you know, they work better for you? How do you look at this?
Both, actually. I mean, it's situational, but just to add to what Nikhil just said, that's actually true, and you know, it just gives me so much perspective just by listening to you, because yesterday itself I rejected an influencer collaboration, and we were trying to reach her from a very long time, and etc. We explained the mood board, etc. But her request was that she doesn't want the brand logo, so we have a mandate that we have a brand logo at the end of the reel as the end slate. And she said that she doesn't want, and I immediately said no. It's the reflex in me, it's that, I don't know, that I was being too anal about it. I want my brand logo, right? Like, as a marketer, you just have that. And I just immediately said no. And thanks, I think I'm going to reach out to her again and maybe, you know, or reopen that conversation.
Now you have some perspective.
No, I definitely do, yeah. To answer your question, both. I think one-off conversations, especially when the budget is too high, and also if we evaluate and we see that the metrics weren't that great, we don't do every brand campaign for conversion as well. Certain campaigns are for just branding. So we just did one with Sanjeeda Sheikh. We have a sub-brand called Libas Art, which is a more premium offering of the brand, where the ASP begins only from 8,000. So we worked with her because we also wanted to tap into the Heera Mandi clout, and the campaign did perform really well with her, for us. So you know, we were just trying to reopen the conversation for future collaborations, but of course the commercials sometimes don't justify. And when you are reopening a conversation because of the metrics, then the ROI has to make sense, right? In that case, no. But otherwise, every influencer we work with, we definitely strike a deal for 2 to 3 collaborations, so that not only just for a better monetary conversation, but also we want to build that recall also on the website. And also we don't see influencers as influencers. We see them, we also want to work with them in a brand advocacy standard, where they work enough and their promotion of the brand should look so authentic, because their audience can also see the brand so many times on their feed that the engagement and the collaborations looks authentic.
Okay, fair enough. In the interest of time, I'll have to come down to my last question. So, Ishu, few your 2 cents on how brands and influencers can synergize better and, you know, perhaps deliver better results in the coming years. Nisha, you can go first. That's fine.
I think in collaboration lies the win-win situation. Me as a marketer and both influencers, we are both working in this creator economy. We all are educating ourselves on what's better. Eventually, the influencer is also making content. After a certain time, when they are just creating their base, they also want to create content for the brand. So we both have to educate and upskill ourselves continuously, and have more empathy towards each other. Like, the influencer shouldn't also be working from the mindset that brands, and brands shouldn't also be like influencer. I think they both should really try to understand. And I think Nikki kind of shed a beautiful light on the fact that understanding of why a creator wants a certain thing, if the brands can understand that better, I think together the end product could make a lot more sense.
So just one thing that I think a lot of times either the brand thinks that they're bigger than the influencer, and at times the influencer thinks they're bigger than the brand. I think it's very important to get that balance right, because if the balance is right, both the influencer and the brand can come together and create some great content. But if there is an imbalance that you see in the content, it'll not be a long-term relationship, like you said, because it'll break for sure, because it's money related, right? And when there's money relation, if there's an imbalance, it'll never be long lasting. So I think it's very important to have both on the same page, even if you're hiring them, but you're hiring them for what they can bring to you and not what you could do, and that's why they're there. So you give them that respect. And influencers should, I think, reciprocate in the similar manner, where they appreciate that the brand's investing time and money in them. So I think both, I think that balance is very important. So
that's a brilliant point. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I think exactly what both of them said. I feel that it needs to be a collaboration. I just feel that, honestly, the creators sometimes feel that they know everything, and, you know, that the brands don't understand content, but they don't know that, you know, these are marketing leads you're dealing with. So, of course, they have something in mind when they're sharing a brief. So, you need to respect that also. And brands also need to understand that if you're paying someone, you're paying them not to be a model and follow a script, but to kind of bring their own flavor to it. So I think, yeah, it just needs to really be a collaboration, really.
I think, you know, we spoke a lot about marketeers and the influencers. I think at the end of the day, what will make it work is people who are consuming that content. And I think it's important to cognize for what trends are there. And I think there are a couple of things that I think are very important. I think purposefulness of what the brand says or what the content is getting created is going to be extremely important going forward, you know. And I think the other important thing is authenticity. I think as we look forward more from a content perspective that people will consume, I think that's what the direction that I feel more and more content influencers will move towards. And I think brands need to use the medium effectively, then they'll have to, you know, ride on these 2 key pillars that I see clearly happening.
Sure, wonderful. I'd now like to open the stage to the audience in case any of you have any questions for the esteemed panelists. Okay, no problem. Great. Thank you very much for your time. I hope everybody had wonderful takeaways from this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.